Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. The Goodwill Committee was launched at the Peace Conference in Bangkok on the 23rd May 2012. Amongst its term of references are number one, to nurture interfaith communities of peace. Number two, to strengthen social cohesion and promote greater social trust through greater appreciation of faith and beliefs across multicultural communities. Number three, to maintain social cohesion and instill solidarity in times of community tensions and conflicts. Shortly, the chairperson of this session will introduce the members to you. I would encourage you to engage them, share your views, and seek answers from them on the interesting topic of building a model city of peace and harmony. I'm sure they have lots to share, as much as you have many ideas for them to hear out. May I now invite Reverend Canon Richard Tutin to chair this dialogue. And also, may I ask all panel members to the stage. The panel members are the Reverend Dr. Jonathan Inkpin, Rector of the Parish St. Luke Church, Miss Nura Behjat, representative of the Baha'i Assembly, Toowoomba, Venerable Uping, Pure Land Learning College Association, Mr. Scott McGrath, Deputy of Chairman of Police Citizens Youth Club, Ms. Tim Knox, Regional Coordinator of Queensland Murray-Darling Committee Aboriginal Program Toowoomba, Mr. Muhammed Haniff from the Pure Land Learning College. Ladies and gentlemen, I will now hand over this session to the chairman of the panel, Reverend Canon Richard Tutin.
Thank you. I think I'll begin from here. We have a very distinguished group on the stage who have been working very hard as the Goodwill Committee of Toowoomba. It's one thing to talk about the theory of educating people for peace and developing peace initiatives. It's another thing to build a model city of peace and harmony, but that's really what we're about this afternoon. And I hope that everyone can join in the conversation. In many ways, it's very unstructured, and we've got till 5 o'clock to have our conversation. And I say that in all sincerity, because quite often, if we don't keep an eye on the time, we get carried away in our chats. Unfortunately, we may lose some very important points. So we're inviting you in the on the floor to ask questions or make comments, but equally to the panel members for their work as well. They too will be pitching in and talking. We'll have microphones to be spread around rather than coming up here all the time, and therefore there are microphones on the floor as well. And I shall be attempting to moderate everything, and that may or may not be an easy task. But would you please put your hands together for the members of the Goodwill Committee. Each one of them brings an expertise to this task from their different perspectives, traditions, and professional life. And so each one, too, has worked very hard, as I said earlier, on the work of the committee. I'm not sure if there's a president, is there, Haniff?
No.
You just come in and...
They're all together.
And that's even better, because that way, you know, you don't have a great structure. But I'm just wondering if one member of the committee, at least, would like to bring us up to speed with where the committee's life is at the moment, and at the same time, just let us
into what the committee is currently doing. And they're all pointing at Jonathan.
I've got the microphone now. Well, we formed last year, and we're really we were finding our feet a little bit and just getting to know one another somewhat. So towards the end of last year, Mr. Haniff and the Multicultural Multifaith Centre came up with a bit of an outline of where we might go, and one of the aspects was having a forum, which is where we are at this point, and one or two initiatives like workshops and so on. So we've started to work on one or two little programs. We've also got a little project that's taking a little longer than we initially thought, but we hope will be useful, which is to produce something for Toowoomba on a little bit of a model of the Singapore community, which explains a little bit very simply in a few pages about each faith, but also relates that to Toowoomba, so it bases it really much more clearly here. And we hope that will be one of an initial resource, perhaps, that can come out of this work that we're doing together. So we're meeting about, I think, probably about once a quarter, am I right in thinking? I think we've only really had about two or three meetings, I think, formally. But we benefited, some of us, some folk went to Bangkok last year for the conference there, and then a few of us joined in Singapore and had an experience there of looking at the model there. So we've learned some lessons there, but also trying to work out what we do here. And then some folk also went to the Sri Lankan conference that the Venerable Master mentioned earlier. So I guess it's those things were drawing some experience and also trying to feed into to other things. I'm working alongside Mr. Haniff and his those who work with him. So I guess we're really very much in a process of evolution, but there are some things that we have started to put into place. And as we get a little bit more confidence in ourselves and with others in the community, I think we will look more clearly at specific projects. And there have been things that have come out of the contact with Singapore, and Tim and others might be able to say that about particular contacts, for instance, in relationship to Aboriginal young people and the opportunities for building bridges and exchange with Singapore. That's not been directly out of this committee, but it's been facilitated by our relationships and the things that have happened. I think we feel we're meeting again on in about 2 weeks' time after this forum to see where we go next. And that really does a great deal depend on what comes out of this forum and the input that you have. So I'm going to shut up now because it's really, it should be over to you for us to listen. We don't feel ourselves as particularly special people. We've just been drawn together, really. We weren't, as it were, elected. We don't see ourselves as representative of all of the sections of the community. That's quite clear. There's certain faith groups that are represented, some aren't. There's some community, significant community bodies like the police that are represented, but there aren't others. But we have those contacts. I think a lot of those contacts we're building up that Mr. Haniff and others have done. So hopefully the Goodwill Committee is a companion in that work.
Okay. I'm just wondering if, Scott, you'd like to bring in from your particular area, the PCYC, just how you see it all fitting in, your work and the PCYC fitting into the work of the Goodwill Committee.
Okay. Certainly, I'm also a police officer. I suppose one of the reasons, and I think I was asked to come on to the committee, was my dual role. I work with the Police Youth Club as well. I have lived in Toowoomba for many years, and I've worked with many, many organisations. And I think my network base and my contacts is something I bring to the committee. We are starting to expand and look at what exists in Toowoomba already. There's already valuable and very good work being done around peace and harmony, and we need to connect with those groups as well, and if we can, support those groups. I know through the college, the Pure Land College, they have a strong belief in education and also that connection with young people in the community. And I think our connection through the youth club can help them understand our local issues and how do we connect with our young people, how do we educate our young people to build a peaceful and harmonious city, which is what we hope for the future.
Mm-hmm. And Tim, in regard to the Indigenous community's involvement with the Goodwill Committee, how are you seeing that and how does that work in with programs that you're already undertaking to promote goodwill with between Indigenous young people and young people in other places?
So I, in my working life, I also work as far west as Mitchell down to the Queensland border, Durrumbandy. So I come in contact with many Indigenous people. I'm quite well known in the Toowoomba community as well. My role, and I think as a member of the Goodwill Committee, is to try and get the Aboriginal community aware of, firstly, the concept, what the Venerable Master has in mind, and also to work together, and I have a passion for youth, and was mentioned there by Jonathan just before about the One People concept in Singapore, and what we want to try and do is to bring the youth, along with Scott and other members of the Goodwill Committee, some Aboriginal youth and non-Indigenous youth involved together, and try and bring the Singaporean youth from multi-faith to Australia and integrate and learn about each other's beliefs and what the future could bring together, especially here in Toowoomba, but also I'll be along with Mr. Haniff and Pure Land Learning College trying to expand this a little bit west as well. But I just wanted to quickly mention also two other very important dates on the Aboriginal calendar is, I think maybe Barry can Google if I'm wrong, May 26 is National Sorry Day in Australia. Very important date for Aboriginal people. Those of you who don't know, is the date is celebrated when Prime Minister Rudd said sorry to the Aboriginal people of Australia for the atrocities and the ill treatment and the mistreatment of the Aboriginal people in the past. So we celebrate that day on May 26th. I think that's the date. And we as the Goodwill Committee would hope that we can do something and celebrate that date. So I'll just get the finger up there from Barry. He's on the phone there. Technology, as Master spoke about before. Thanks. May 26th. And we would hope that we could possibly, along with the Goodwill Committee and the Toowoomba City Council and other agencies in Toowoomba, celebrate that date. The other important date is the NAIDOC, which is National Aboriginal Islander Celebration Week, and that's the 7th to the 14th of July. Is another important period that we can work together here in Toowoomba. We have a NAIDOC committee. I'm not a part of the committee, but I know quite a number of people that are on there. And those of you who know Barry Sheehan here, one of his staff members is highly active in the NAIDOC committee and will be working, I hope, with the Goodwill Committee and the NAIDOC committee to try and be part of their activities and express what we as the Goodwill Committee and the Pure Land Learning College Master Venerable wishes of creating Toowoomba as a city of peace and harmony. Thank you.
You're right about the dates, Tim. You got it down square. The week of reconciliation in May is quite important throughout Queensland and Australia. So certainly there'll be a lot going on. Nura, you're a member of the Baha'i faith, and what do you see the Goodwill Committee achieving from your particular tradition and perspective?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Probably some of the friends here know that the main ideology and philosophy of the Baha'i faith is unity. And there are a number of principles, spiritual principles, brought to mankind by Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i faith, that they all revolve around unity. The main one and the pivot around which all other principles revolve is unity of mankind. And within this unity, there are a number of principles, other principles, such as, for example, equality of the rights and privileges, not necessarily the functions. Please don't get me wrong. Rights and privileges of men and women. Now in Australia, for example, we know that, you know, this is story of the past. But in many parts of the world, women are still subject to injustice, to cruelty. They don't have any right. And so this is one of the principles. Another principle is the principle of universal education. That, as we heard from Master Chinkong as well, Baha'u'llah has said, lack of education, lack of a universal education is the major cause, is ignorance, and ignorance is the major cause of lack of peace, of war, of strife. And there are many other principles. But I would like to draw your attention to one of the writings of Baha'u'llah, and that says, the well-being of mankind, its peace and security are unattainable unless and until its unity is firmly established. And I realize that may sound a little bit simplistic, but really, if we think, we all talk about togetherness, coming together, acknowledging each other, but it is said in the Baha'i literature that this unity and strife, they are all the symptoms of a disease. The main disease is disunity amongst people of the world. And I'm so happy this morning, a number of times, the speaker spoke about we are all one. Rabbi mentioned that in reality, really we are all human beings. And until and unless we don't recognize that we are one species, human, we cannot come to peace and tranquility. And very briefly, one more thing, I think we talk about spiritual education. Education, we have spoken about all levels of education. But one thing that I believe is very important is that we start education from very childhood. Yes, university is great, adults and youth, and they can go to universities, but I believe education, particularly spiritual education, must start from childhood, in our family, within our schools. We have to start some sort of a spiritual education in the curriculum of schools. All these beautiful things we are talking to the converted. We gotta make sure that there is a program in schools that talk about the major oneness of the fundamental principles of religion. Sorry, if you let me, I rave until night. I apologize.
Okay. I was going to ask if Venerable Wu Ping or Mr. Haniff wanted to say anything, but I do have someone from the floor. And anyone from the floor, if you could just say who you are, and that would be helpful as part of the conversation.
Hello. There's a go. My name's Chantel Shaw. Can I say I'm representing the Jewish people? I know. Actually, thank you, Nora, because that was a really lovely segue. It was like we talked about it before we went up, but we didn't. So my question is, because when I was one of the people that went to Bangkok, and one of, well, part of the forums is that we talked about education and how we should be educating the children. And one of the concepts that came out was that perhaps we should be developing a curriculum that can be put into the education system as part of the schooling system rather than an outside thing that just comes in. And I'm wondering how the Goodwill Committee can go about creating a subcommittee to work with Education Queensland to write a good curriculum, perhaps as a pilot using Toowoomba to see how that worked. And what was that? Using the Goodwill Committee to as a force to work with Queensland Education and getting that put written and put into the schools. And is that something you're willing to take on?
Tim.
Thanks, Chantelle. I'll just speak from a Aboriginal perspective. The Queensland Studies Authority, they make up the curriculums for schools. At the present, over the last 4 or 5 years, Aboriginal language is being developed as a curriculum. At the moment we have what they call LOAT, language other than English. In one of the two of the schools in my district, they teach the traditional language of the current tribal area. In Toowoomba, we would have it very, 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 very difficult to teach Aboriginal language in a school in Toowoomba. As Gwen mentioned earlier, the traditional owners of this land, the Jarawa and Gaibal people, their population isn't very big in a city of this size. You have lots and lots and lots of other Aboriginal tribes. It would be very difficult for me to be able to let my child be taught an Aboriginal language other than my own first. As most would know, Aboriginal languages, there's some 600 languages across Australia, and I would prefer to have my children taught their home language first, their tribal language. Now, how does this lead to religion? I know that, but it would be the same from an Aboriginal perspective. We have different beliefs, different dreamings. As you heard me this morning speak, my God, so to speak, is Bayami. Gwen's would be different to mine. So to teach a religion or a belief or a dreaming across a whole bunch of kids in a school in an Aboriginal perspective would be very, very difficult. But I'm not saying that it shouldn't be done, but we have to tread very lightly in how, from an Aboriginal perspective, how we teach other Aboriginal kids about another. I suppose it's just like a religion, teaching my kids Baha'i or something.
I respond?
I'm just providing you with a bit of a background on how difficult it would be for the. Not to say that the Goodwill Committee isn't aiming towards that, but we want to bring people together and be united from their perspective, their beliefs, and that. So I just wanted to put that.
Okay, so I understand and I accept what you're saying. I think it's very valid. What I'm thinking is that, being Jewish, my children attend a state school and they receive, if I choose for them, to have a religious education solely based on Christianity. That's what's currently in the schools. Now, I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but that excludes my children from being part of the religious education program. So I feel, and like Venerable, Master Venerable, Ching Kung said, is that you don't teach them about Judaism specifically or Baha'i specifically, you teach them morality, ethics and virtue. And if you listened carefully to what he said, he talked about, in essence, I'll go back to what he said just very quickly, you have to treat people how you want to be treated. Now you tell me how many religions that particular morality lives within, and I can tell you at least five that's standing here. So by teaching that one ethic, you're teaching across the religions, not about one religion.
Any member of the Goodwill Committee want to keep responding?
I'd like to respond. I feel very drawn to what you're saying as an issue. I do think it needs quite a considerable consultation and reflection on how we go about it, and I think it's probably a stepped process. I grew up in the UK, where religious education is part of the mainstream of and of all schools, and something that therefore introduces every child to an understanding of both those things that are common within the faiths, and also some of those things that are distinct. And I think some of the things that are distinct are also important. I don't agree with Venerable Master Ching Kung that religion, I'm not sure he did actually when he went on, but that you can boil religion down basically just to education. I feel that certainly within the Abrahamic faiths, at the very least, it's actually something which has more to do with encounter and response, not just a teaching and distillation of values. But those things need to be also somehow put into the system. But here in Australia, we have a history of being a country that began out of the to try and not repeat the horrendous mistakes and conflicts of European history, that religion was, in a sense, kept separate, and that was quite deliberate so that we didn't have conflicts even between Christian traditions in schools, especially in secular education. And that was done for quite good reasons. Where we now end up, I think, but that was a mistake for us now, when we need, as a community in a global village, to really understand, have some understanding. I think our children need to have some understanding of the breadth of difference, as well as those things that are common. So, but to move on these things is really quite difficult. It's been quite painful, I think, for those who've been involved in Christian education, to try and bring together the Christian faith to operate responsible and effective religious instruction system in their schools, in schools, and that's taken a leap forward recently in Toowoomba through the Ministers Association, where there's common agreement across the churches through the leaders and others, and to work on a common program, and so that's actually accepted and understood, and importantly that's recognised by the authority and by schools and heads of schools. So this isn't just a one group with one particular thing, but something that's owned across the board. So to do that for the broader community of faith groups and other interested parties is quite a big task, is what I'm saying. That shouldn't stop us doing that. I think my experience of working in Sydney is that there are other ways and models of at least putting steps in process. I was involved with the initiative that Rabbi Castell in Sydney has worked effectively across the country, of the Goodness and Kindness project. That's one way in which that people together from the different faiths can come together and share common values, and to work on and to share the unity that we have, as well as and not so much touch on the difference. So there are some, that isn't the only one that's around. And I think maybe it's working on those things and having some steps forward, working also with some of the denominational schools, like the Catholic schools, which have got very good programs and curricula, which trying to introduce their children to a range of different faith perspectives, as well as to ground them properly in the Catholic understanding of Christian faith. So those things, I think it needs quite a lot of consideration, but that shouldn't stop us making initial steps. And maybe we can work with a few schools to begin with, or even one or two. That would make us make this step along the way.
My point is that I would like to see it come away from a Christian-based perspective and have a range of people. And I think the Baha'i have a really good model, and I hope, Nura, is that's what you're about to talk about. Because my son, and I'll tell you why, my son wants to go as a rabbi to Multicultural Day, and a child at his school said, well, good, I'm coming as Hitler. So there has to be more education to the younger kids so they understand why saying that isn't a nice thing.
What I think we'll do at this juncture, I'll hear from Nura. Did you want to add? No. And then we'll move on to another question. So, Nura, please, and
thank
then
you
we'll
so
move on
much.
To another question.
I would like to respond to Shanta. First of all, thank you, Shanta. We always talk about these issues with each other. I would like a bit apology to all the friends here ask, what is our fear, really? We all stand here and we say, oh, we all are saying the same thing, we have to come together, we got to accept each other. But why is it that it is so terrifying to talk about religion? I mean, let's analyze this word religion. What is religion? What is a religion made of? To me, as a Baha'i, religions are made of two parts. One is the fundamental principles, if I can call them, the virtues of humanity. Please tell me, which one of the religions are saying that be bad, that do not love your neighbor, that kill, that do adultery, that steal from each other? Is there any religion that we know of and we can name that they encourage these things? The second part of every religion is the social part of it. That is the part that can and must progress according to the exigencies of time. So the fundamental and main part of the religions, they're all the same. They're all that commonality that we are talking about. They are all the goodness of all the religions from the time of Adam until the time, the end of the time, that there is no end to it. Religions have come to create brotherhood, goodness, unity, but unfortunately they change after a while. And I don't want to go to the cause of these changes, but all essentially teach us about goodness. Then it comes about the secondary issues, which is rituals or social principles, and they change because the world changes. Now what I would like to suggest, and we have discussed this, and I really love what Master Ching Kung says, and as a Baha'i, I can't be happier about it, that we must teach the children. They have the right to know about all the religions. I cannot limit my child to know only about my religion. To me, this is not fair to that child. But having said that, I want also, because my dear friend Chantel mentioned this, yes, the Baha'i faith has developed a curriculum that teaches, one, all the virtues of humanity that are in common in all the religions, two, the life and teachings of all the major religions of the world. Unfortunately, in some of the schools, and we run in 5 schools in Toowoomba, unfortunately, sometimes we have difficulties, and I don't want to go to that, but yes, we do have a curriculum. I'll be delighted to explain further if you would like to. But these classes talk about virtues that are in common and the teachings of all the major religions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Narendrapal Singh from Melbourne. I've come here actually representing the Sikh faith. I've just stepped down from the Parliament of World Religions. And I think what Chantel brought up is quite correct. We used to face the same issues in Melbourne. There is a curriculum that's fully supported from Canberra. There is a lady who wrote a PhD paper on this, Anna. She's now at Deakin University, and I'd be happy to give her email address to any one of you to deal with her directly and to get the information from her. I think what's happened now is we're in a transition period. Children are mixing with other children of different faiths, cultures. In the years to come, they will be very comfortable with each other and the different religions that they meet. On the other hand, from the top, from Canberra down to the cities, down to the smaller towns, more rationalization of this will take place, and there will be a meeting point in the next few years where it will be rationalized properly. We had the same problem initially in Melbourne in schools. You have classes, we call it RI, religious instruction, or RE, religious education in schools. The Catholic, Anglican, independent schools had a curriculum. The public schools were the ones that were a bit behind. All right? But right now they're playing catch up. So whenever, it all depends on the community to push the project, the religious group to push the project and say, when you have Christian lessons in this school, we will provide a teacher for all those of my faith during that period for our students and our children there. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Dr. Heppel. No, the microphone's just down from you, sir.
I was surprised it seems to be that almost nobody in our community knows that in the world there is a university for peace. And just to fill in a little bit of detail, there is a university for peace that's been established in Costa Rica. Costa Rica abolished its army in 1948. Now, there was communion between Costa Rica and the United Nations, and so a treaty was set up between the United Nations and Costa Rica, which established a university for peace in Costa Rica, and it has several branches in other parts of the world. And my suggestion is that the Pure Land Movement gets together with the University of Peace in Costa Rica, which gives degrees, master's degrees, and doctoral degrees in peace, and studies peace a lot, that these two organizations could learn a lot from each other and should put their heads together.
Yeah. Hang on. We've got quite a few people over here. I might go to this side of the room first before you, Peter, if you don't mind. And once you've spoken, sir, I might then ask if there's any response to what's been discussed so far.
My name is John Pugh. I'm a Muslim, and I'm also a scout leader. And the question I guess, or a consideration that I'd like to put to the Goodwill Committee is that we're talking about utilising schools. Now, at the moment, schools may not be accessible because of the fact of curriculum and politics and whatever. But there are a number of other community groups that children are involved in, including scouts, guides, interact groups. Is there a way that we can start to utilise these groups as a way to reach out to children as a form of education? Being a scout leader, you have to have a belief in God, and that's what it is. And there's no reason why we can't be utilising these people, these groups, I just lost the word then, but utilising the groups that are already existing, children who are gathering together, having fun, learning about things, learning about peace. It's a very simple concept. It doesn't need to go to schools. It branches from there. So, thanks.
You've created quite a stir because the microphone was going up and down the members of the Goodwill Committee at 100 k's an hour. Venerable Wu Ping.
Yeah, I think I agree with this gentleman what he say. Yes, we can. I think the mainly education would depend on the parents. Most of the time, they stay with parents, not the teacher. Teachers is half time. So the parents, how they teach their children, more important than than the school, because the good, actually the religion, we had to base on the basic how to be a good person. I think every religion talked about the principle and about how to be a good person. So to teach people to be a good person, like I think he's a rabbi says, love your neighbor, love thy your neighbor. Yeah, if we can teach this, then we won't have those discrimination or those conflicts. So it depends on the parents should educate, receive the education first, learn. If they have faith, either don't have faith, everybody had to be a good person. Everybody should learn that principle. And when they learn the principle, and most and children learn from people's example. From whose example? Parents' example and teachers' example. So actually I think if to educate the children, we should learn to be a good example first. Then children learn our example. You know, most children learn from the adults' example. And the most, the worst, I would say the worst thing is most children learn from internet, from TV. How are we going to solve this problem? I think this problem is even worse than how they learn from the school. This is my answer. And also, I think that many of you have already learned from my teacher, Venerable Master Ching Kong. And also, I would like to express in the Goodwill community, and we also have another brother, Buddhist brother, Venerable U Ching. Because I'm elder, so I'm here. Thank you.
Mr. Haniff.
Yeah, just John, just to add on to what you say, and just an addendum to what Venerable Wuping says, I think you give a very, very good opening and a very good suggestion. I think that's what something which we in the members of the Goodwill Committee will certainly give it a thought, because you need to reach out to every segment of the community, because this is a journey that should not be bordered, but there should be no borders in the sense that these are the groups only. So we thank you for that, and certainly we'll do something about that. Thank you very much, John.
Okay.
Right. Good afternoon. I'm Kamara Muhammad. I'm a PhD student from Singapore. I would just like to suggest the Singapore model. We are the education in Singapore is secular. The religion is taught by the community. The children go to the mosque, the church to learn about religion. But in schools, they are taught moral education and social studies. So they don't offend any of the denomination. So schools don't teach religion. Thank you.
Okay. Now, if I can get the microphone to come down to Peter in the front table on your side.
Wrong. Yeah.
Yep, just here. No, the blue one.
Wrong, please.
Hello, everyone. My name's Peter. I'm the founder.
To the mouth, Peter.
To the mouth. I'm the founder of a place we call the Interfaith Church. The name may change. It's only been around for a couple of years, but I've had someone suggest we should change that name because church implies Christian, and we're not Christian, we're pluralist. So Australia's first pluralist church. Now, I'm also someone that's interested in lifelong learning, and I've been learning for most of my life. I'm an educator as well. At the moment, I've just completed a course with the University of Edinburgh about philosophy. I'm currently studying with USQ in education, and I've never been to either of the campuses. So one of the things that's really exciting for me, and the way some of our youth learn at the moment, is the ability to learn online. What's called a massive open online course is available. That's actually where I did my last philosophy course with the University of Edinburgh, and this is probably a potential for the very exciting idea of a multi-faith university. However, I think the issue with the university is it can do more. Universities tend to teach adults, but we should be teaching humanity. If we have people that are willing to write a curriculum in Baha'i faith or Buddhism or in Aboriginal language, which is closely tied to the belief system and the dreaming of each group of people, we could then put that online, and the Aboriginal children of one group could go online during their religious study time and study their language and their dreaming. The Baha'i could go online and study their belief system. Of course, there's other issues here too in computer literacy, and maybe that also needs to be addressed. But I was just wondering, Tim, maybe you could respond, and is that something that might work for the Aboriginal community?
Yes, I'm guessing that would be an option. As we all know, kids are all on Facebook or Twitter or have an iPhone or an Android phone of some sort. So technology has caught up and rapidly going past me. But the younger people, yes. I can just talk on behalf of my tribe, the Kamilaroi people. We're one of only a few in Australia. If you search Aboriginal language, you will find a dictionary on the internet with words and pronunciations and whatnot of my language. We have a language centre. My tribe have a language centre in Walgett, New South Wales, and they also teach. I think they do a small online service, but in Sydney, which is not in my tribal area, they at one of the TAFE, they have a summer school for my language, because our tribe comes from in southwest Queensland, way down into middle of New South Wales. It's the largest tribes, other than the tribe below us, I think, the Wiradjuri in Australia. So a very large tribe, but I can only speak from my tribal things, but we do have these type of accessed teachings. So yes, that could be a way to teach the beliefs and the stories of each of the tribes or each of the religions. But going back to Nura's comments made earlier, and Chantel's, is that we should be teaching a snippet of each of the beliefs and faith of Australia and the now multicultural Australia.
Thank you.
Something I should have mentioned as well was with that there's
the potential that if you're creating courses for your own faiths, we can take snippets of that and build a real first Australian, a comparative course in religion for RE at school,
yeah,
which is something that is incredibly, greatly needed.
Going to butt in a bit right here, because I'm keeping a close eye on that time. The numbers on the wall get bigger every minute. I'm wondering, though, we've been talking a lot about religious education and religion, but we also have to work and be in harmony and peace with those who hold no belief, who are atheists. And I'm wondering how we can respond as a goodwill committee to that particular part of our community who are also looking for peace and harmony, but certainly don't hold anything in common with the beliefs that many of us hold in this room. But we do need to respond and work with them. And I'm just wondering, has that work come... Oh, everyone's got their hand up. They've all been talking about it. I'll start with Nura and then we'll work our way around a bit, but that's where I'd like to like us to head, because our goal today is building a city of peace and harmony, not a religious city of peace and harmony. So it's peace education, yes, but we're building, the topic for right now is building a city of peace and harmony. That's what's in the program. So I'd like us to work with that side of the community for a few minutes. Nura.
My colleagues are telling me, Tim, give chance to another person. And I just told him, I've been counting. Every one of you had two goals. So I start with the third one and you can have the third goal. Is that fair enough? Equality, that's what I mean.
Whose goal is ruling now?
I'm going now. Reverend is wonderful. Say go for it, Nura. Thank you, Reverend. Well, very quickly, first of all, I wanted to thank our young gentleman there who suggested that we can teach to all the clubs and others similar. I can't agree more. Thank you very, very much. In fact, this, if I may say, the Baha'i community has tried to do, not necessarily going to clubs, but the Baha'i community is open to all religions. We encourage, we invite, and we actually do have many kids of various religions. That's that, but I do appreciate you saying that. Yes, starting with schools perhaps is not the easiest thing. As far as the view of the Goodwill Committee, I let all my colleagues to correct me, but my view is that actually it is a very tender and gentle view about the people we call non-religions, or religious, or whatever, people who don't believe necessarily the way we believe in religions. Personally, I have a view, but before I say that, is that the committee actually always emphasizes that we should take steps towards embracing all the people. Therefore, maybe, in fact, please correct me, sometimes when some of us, including me, we keep saying religion, religion, Father Brian and Reverend, they always say that we should talk in a way to attract all the people, regardless. So the committee is actually very, very conscious of this matter. But in my personal view, and please, I'm going to open another can of worms, forgive me. Don't get annoyed with me, I'm going to say it. To me, all the people, all the goodness, should I say it? To me, all the root of all the goodness is from a divine source. We may not believe in that divine source, but where has goodness come from? It was not growing on the tree. It was not hidden under the ground. Goodness and purity and divinity should have come from somewhere. People who believe in religions, and I'm not saying that's the only way to go about it, they believe that the founder of religions, they are the ones, they are the bringers of message of peace and goodness. Please don't get annoyed with me, but this is what I feel. Goodness has not come from somewhere in ether. Maybe it has come from ether, because it has come from the prophet, like all these messengers, manifestations of God, spiritual teachers. So I believe still we are having one thing in common. We all believe in morality and goodness.
Scott?
I suppose, just looking back at our meetings through the Goodwill Committee, we've certainly had discussions around trying to make our inclusion not just religious-based. We acknowledge there's a lot of people that either have had bad experiences from religious groups or religious, I suppose, organisations, and there are people that have very different beliefs about what spirituality is, where our goodness comes from, all those sorts of things. So we've certainly looked at that as a goodwill committee and how we include everyone. I suppose from, this is my personal view, is I have my own journey with my religion and where I come from. I've married a lady who does not believe in Christianity, does not believe in a religion as such. But the way she behaves in her life, the way she teaches her children, the way she looks at many different views and is non-judgmental, is kind, generous. She's not a Christian, she's not a Baha'i, she's not any of those faiths. And I admire her and believe she has those bases that are in other religions. She has that within herself and she's been taught those things. So I suppose within my position on the committee, I have been seeing what Buddhism, the Buddhists believe in what's inside people. It starts from in here, whether you're Christian, Baha'i, any faith, or non-believing, it starts from your heart, within you, what you believe in and how you act and how you behave in a community, in front of your children, in front of other people, the messages you give out. So that's, I think, my perspective on non-religion. And I think if you can behave in a morally good way, in a presentable way, you know, all those things we've talked about, being good, is what it's about. And that's my little point.
Thank you. How many people in the on the floor here do want to say something in the next few minutes? Could I just have an indication? Who haven't spoken yet? If you haven't spoken yet, that would be great to hear from you. I think Vivian is connected, the microphone going there, and then there's that person over here. Okay, Vivian.
First of all, I thank you everyone, all the venerables and the relevant and all the religious leaders. And I think the peace education is a big issue. I think if we discussion, we can discussion for a long time. For my personal thinking, I think the peace education from ourselves, individual, from ourselves, then our family, then our school, then our society and community, eventually our religions. So then we just step and step. I doing the peace education from ourselves, think no conflicts. Sometimes with ourselves, with conflicts with ourselves. So this is my a little bit and suggesting, doing from ourselves, then our family, a peaceful family, then peaceful society. Just like the Rigma said, the happiness from myself, individual, then my family, then my community, then the school mass, students, teacher, then all the religions. Thank you very much for everyone.
Well, we were having the question about reaching out to atheists. I do a lot of volunteer work. And
could you say who you are, please?
Oh, sorry. Rachel Akers, General Ratbag, for those who don't know me. It should come with the warning. As I say, I do a lot of volunteer with atheists, and I think it's absolutely incredible. I love working with them. They've got such a marvellous, healthy attitude towards life. And I was thinking, I would love to see reach out and have them involved in these type of forums. But the only way I think we can do this, and again, like Nura, I'm opening a can of worms, is that we really need to recognise what the atheists have undergone. I mean, a lot of them have been harassed, a lot of them have been... some of the hatred I've seen aimed towards atheists, because people think because they don't have a religion, they've got no morals, that they don't have a religion, that they don't have any community spirit. And if we're going to reach out to the atheists, we need to recognise that the hurt these people have received. Because if there's one thing I know about atheism, there's no common homogeneous dogma or anything like that, but they just want to live their lives without having someone Bible bash them, if you pardon the figure of speech. And a lot of them have encountered a hell of a lot of that in their times. And I really think if we're going to do that, we need to address this. Thank you.
Any response from the committee, Jonathan?
I recognise that, and I think that's important to recognise that. I think you also have to count that atheism has also destroyed millions and millions of people through people like Stalin and Mao and other horrendous people. So there's another side to it, and that's one of the things I feel quite strongly is that we shouldn't be stereotyping anything or anybody, and that all ideas and all groups have the potential for the demonic, and they can destroy. Whether you're an atheist, whether you're a religious person, whatever ilk. So it's trying to go beyond that. When I was at university, it was just before Thatcher got to power in England and Reagan in America, and the campaign for nuclear disarmament was very small. And when I turned up for a meeting, there were three people there. One was a Quaker, one was a Catholic nun, and the other one was a Marxist with a dog. And it seems to me, whenever I go around, now I would add the Baha'i would probably be there. Baha'is weren't so strong. But my point I'm making is that it doesn't really matter when you come to fundamental issues of peace and justice and trying to save this planet, which we're hell-bent on destroying. It really doesn't matter where you come from. And we need as much wisdom and as much value we can derive from anywhere. But what doesn't help sometimes, when I was coming to Toowoomba, I looked up and see if there was a peace group, and I couldn't find anything on the web except for a few years ago when there was a campaign against, obviously, the Iraq war. And the person who put the thing up said, oh, we're in for peace, but we don't want any Christians in it because they might talk about God. And, you know, that's the other side of it. It's like, you know, for Christians, it's important to be able to talk about Christ. You know, don't bash everyone else around the head, but don't also exclude that from discussion as well, for personal expression. So it's moving on. So for me, the answer to working with anyone, I don't like the word non-religious because I think people have all kinds. I watched Richard Dawkins' program the other day, and he had, although he has a difficulty of understanding monks and all kinds of religious experience, he clearly has a sense of wonder at the world and a sense of the sacred. So there are ways in which we can connect on that kind of a level. But above all, we can connect in terms of doing something about justice. Wasn't it wonderful this morning when we heard from the mayor that we might be designated as a city that was welcoming to refugees? You know, the plight of asylum seekers is appalling, the changes that have been made by the government. Now, everyone can get behind that who has a heart for human rights and for justice. And part of the problem for Christians is that you know, Jesus spent most of his time, he wasn't really all that bothered with religion with a capital R. What he was bothered with was what's really important, the sacred things of life, our environment, one another, how we love one another. Those things are religious for me with a small R. But Christians sometimes have gone into turning this into religion with a big R. If we get back to the heart of those things, we'll find all kinds of things people will join in. And I don't really mind too much whether or not they turn up to this, that, or the other church or temple or whatever, or if they find there some sort of nurture in walking these marvelous land that we have around us.
Okay, my name's Betty. I'd like to just pick up on what the moderator has said, that this is a forum about peace and harmony, and there has been far too much mention, in my opinion, on the issues of religion and faith. And there are many of us here who have what I would prefer to call a philosophy of life. And I think if Jesus were walking on this earth today, and I happen to have been raised as a Catholic, I am now not a Catholic, I'm not an agnostic, I'm not an atheist, I am a person who holds some philosophical beliefs, and I would like to see this particular forum focus more on the issue of philosophy, which can include all of the underlying issues that have been raised. Philosophy based on respect for ourselves and respect for others incorporates any decent religion or other type of faith, but the words multi-faith and religion I find very off-putting, and yet I want to be involved in what is going on here, and I'm finding it increasingly difficult to do so because I don't like those words, and I wonder how many other people find them off-putting as well. I would like the forum to concentrate on its heading, on its topic. It's a peace and education forum. It is not a religious forum, and it needs to be based on a philosophy of respect for ourselves and respect for others. Thank you.
Mr. Haniff.
Yeah, sorry, Betty. Thank you very much for raising that. I think that's what all about the question of dialogue, that I'm very sure you have that sense of confidence to say that, because that's what we are all here about, to address this issue. Now, the Goodwill Committee is striving very hard. Like I said, we're just less than a year. There are many things that we are still lacking on. But if you just reflect back on the title of the forum, what we have today, if you realize that it's about peace education, it's about building bridges, and it's about sharing ideas. Now, it is inevitable that sometimes everyone has some way or other, like you say, faith and non-faith. But it's always that question will come in. But then again, we're trying, as I said, if you look at that perspective of, if you reflect back on your programs there, there are programs that we're talking about being inclusive and integration. So I think that itself is philosophical. If you understand the word, I mean, if we all know what is inclusive. Inclusive is basically, is to accept. We have not reached that level yet, because most often than not, we say tolerate. But if you ask me personally, I will not want to tolerate. I want to accept you for what you are. So that's what it should be, right? I think that's the level that we should go. Now, we will try to connect to as many people as possible. That is why the Goodwill Committee, when we sat down, we say that this forum is open to anyone who wants to walk in. There should be no restriction at all. Even a person that comes in the last minute, accept that person. So I think on that basis, I'd like to end off, because I know we are very much, short of time, but I'll leave it to the moderator to take it off from there.
Yeah. We have a minute. Use it well, he says. I couldn't see, now I know where I'm heading. Yeah. The last comment for the afternoon, I think. No, we're having a...
She's had a hand up for a while.
Yeah. Would you like to say something?
Yeah, please.
And you'll be bringing us all into the final stages of this discourse.
I'm Diane Lukes. I'm the past president of Esperanto in Australia, and I'd like to point out that we could do something by introducing Esperanto into the schools in Toowoomba as an example for the rest of Australia, which is a way towards peace. So, is my minute up?
I'll give you 20. Keep going a little bit more, because you are making a very important point.
We have been actually to the federal government, and they suggested that we should. It was Julia Gillard when she was the Director of Education, and she said we should go to the state people. We went to them, she even gave us the names of the people to go to. They said we should go back to the federals because they're the one with the money and they're the ones who decide. Then we went back there, they said the only thing we can do is go to the communities, go to the mums and dads, see. We'd like to get it in Esperanto into the primary schools to teach the little children. Then by the time they finish their primary school, they will be bilingual. this will be a big help for them to understand people in the rest of the world and bring about unity. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This brings our discourse to a close, and I think each and every one of us who's spoken and those of us who've indicated with their support through applause, we've made some very important points this afternoon, and I think we've given a lot of food for thought for the Goodwill Committee to keep working on. It is important to recognise sometimes that it's easy to get bogged down in our own little areas of life, and yet we're called to be people of broad thoughts and wide reach. And so there's a lot to talk about tomorrow in tomorrow's program, and there'll be a lot more to share, and I hope we're able to share with each other, not just in the formal sessions, but also over the tea and the coffee and the meals as well. Would you please thank all members of the Goodwill Committee who are on the stage? And also point out that a couple of members of the committee weren't able to come today. One is Mr. Roberto Garcia, who's the Multicultural Officer for the Toowoomba Regional Council, and Father Brian Sparksman, who's the Chancellor of the Roman Catholic Diocese of Toowoomba. Both of those are heavily involved in the Goodwill Committee, but unfortunately couldn't be here this afternoon. Thank you very much for participation, and I hope you have a very safe journey home, and look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend, and the panel members. Dear distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have now come to the end of today's program. Thank you.